Good morning and welcome to the 17th meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2023. I've received apologies from Paul Sweeney and from Emma Harper, MSP, and we're joined remotely by James Dornan, MSP. Agenda item one is business and private, and this is for the committee to decide whether to take item three in private. Are members agreed?
Yes.
Thank you very much. Agenda item two is follow-up scrutiny of the complex mesh surgical service. And for this morning's session, I welcome Jenny Minto, Minister for Public Health and Women's Health, and Greg Chalmers, Head of the Chief Medical Officer's Policy Division from the Scottish Government. And we are going to move straight into questions. Minister, if I can ask, there are plans to create a single patient leaflet available to women at the point of referral to the service. Why is that leaflet not already been designed, given the length of time that the service has been in operation? And how will the leaflet clearly explain the various elements of their whole referral and treatment journey, whether they opt for surgery in service or in NHS England or with a private provider?
First of all, I'd like to thank the convener and the committee for inviting me along and also recognising the experiences, the quite traumatic experiences that women have experienced as a result of the transvaginal mesh surgery. I think what's really clear is when we have started setting up this surgery system for women who have been impacted, that we wanted to design the processes with these women in mind and ensure that we did the right thing for them. So there's been a lot of discussion and surveys done with women impacted to find out how they feel that this service should be operating. And I think taking that learning on board has been incredibly important. And there are some advice actually on the NHS Inform website. But I think bringing out a pamphlet, literature to support women is incredibly important. And we've listened to the women to ensure that that contains the right information, whether it's the pathways for the referral system within the Greater Glasgow and Clyde service, or whether it's the independent service. But I'm pleased that we have listened to the women and then are able to provide them with the information they have specifically highlighted as needing.
Thank you for that answer. So in terms of that leaflet, can you give us some timescales around about when that will be available to women?
I'm afraid I can't, but Greg Chalmers, maybe.
Yeah, just to say, convener, you're quite right, as Dr. Mailer's confirmed in his note to you, which I saw just this morning. They are and have been developing a patient information leaflet. We don't have a date specifically for when it will be available, but we'll seek to confirm that with the GGC after today. What I would say, as you no doubt know, convener, and others will know, of course, when women attend the when patients attend the service, they are provided with a range of information there when attending, specifically about their surgery, but also, of course, about the range of other conditions that a patient might be relevant to a patient, as well as receiving a telephone call beforehand from a psychologist. So I think you make and I'm sure GGC would say this if they were here, valid point about continuing to improve that information. But it is one part of a number of things that GGC have done, including of course keeping on improving the website.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to move to Sandesh Gulhani.
Thank you. Thank you, Minister, for joining us. Minister, when did the bill get passed?
The bill was passed in 2021-22.
And so between the time that it took to come into force and all the planning that went into it, and now, why is there not a clear pathway for women to get referred into the service? Why is there confusion?
So my understanding is that there is a clear pathway. I was on the NHS Inform website and I saw it this morning, and I have a copy of it here, which is described as the Complex Meth Surgical Service Pathway, which I would be very happy to submit after this evidence session to the committee.
So, I mean, we heard from a number of people, and we're hearing that there's direct referrals from GPs. We're hearing that actually it's a secondary care referral pathway. So if people who are coming to us aren't being absolutely explicit, how do we expect other people to know what the pathway is and the way to follow it?
So I thank you for that question. And if I recall, the evidence that you received 2 weeks ago indicated that the pathway was clearly laid out, that there was an electronic referral to the GCC Complex Mesh Surgical Service, and that was the clear pathway that has been introduced. But I think Greg Chalmers would like to come in.
Yeah, just to all the matter of the Act. I suppose it's important in this discussion, of course, to try not to conflate the two things, a number of things that are going on. The Mesh Removal Act 2022, which was, I think, gained royal assent in January or slightly later from recollection, that's about the reimbursement of already entered into private expenditure for women that have went for mesh removal surgery, generally in the United States, but also in Bristol. So that's a separate process from the commissioning of independent surgery through the NHS now, and obviously from the NHS service in Greater Glasgow and Clyde. And so after the 2022 Act was passed, as the committee may well know, we published the administrative scheme that underpins the 2022 Act, and there is an information leaflet, available through NSS, who administer the scheme on our behalf. So that's separate from, so the date of royal assent, yeah.
But when you are thinking of a reimbursement scheme, and we are talking about pathways for women who have suffered and are struggling, these all go hand in hand. You know, the thought of what to do with the women who are struggling in pain, unable to get the help they require, is something that I was under the impression the government was looking at during the bill and the act that was passed. So that's why the question was framed in that manner. And so my final question on the referral pathway, can you tell me, is it possible for a GP to directly refer into this pathway?
So my understanding is that the GP refers to their local health board, which then refer to the complex mesh surgical service, which is managed by NSS and Greater Glasgow and Clyde.
Thank you. I'm going to move now to Tess White, who's got questions on this theme, and Tess is joining us remotely.
Thank you, Convener. Two questions, if I may, Minister. The first question is, we've heard that one mesh injured woman has debilitating pain, and she's been waiting for 82 weeks for an urgent referral. So what guidance is being given to health boards to manage women with mesh patients?
Tess White for her question. It is clear that what NSS have been doing is sending out information to health boards, and each health board has got a person, an individual who is has been tasked with the responsibility for ensuring that that health board area understands the complex mesh service.
And Minister, just
sorry, and Greg Chalmers would like to add to that.
So I beg your pardon.
Okay.
Just say, if I could just say at this point, we hope to be joined this morning by our clinical advisor, Dr. Terry O'Kelly. Unfortunately, he was taken rather ill last week, so I should apologise if there's explicitly clinical things that were asked this morning, which we're not able to answer. If that happens, we'll take that away. But hopefully we'll be able to be as helpful as possible. To come to Ms. White's question, we are aware of, as you'd imagine, in the government, we do become aware of particular cases from time to time, I think we are aware of the situation to which the member refers, and I do think it is the case that the individual that the member is referring to has been contacted by their health board, they are following up as a matter of urgency, and have arranged for a telephone appointment to take place with the consultant. Now, obviously, that period of time of wait will be profoundly distressing and difficult for the individual involved, that would not be disputed. Of course, it would not be disputed, but by the government. In general, of course, GGC in the specialist mesh centre is taking steps to reduce the waiting times from a position which I think all involved acknowledge does not require improvement, but as the situation has developed and the service has been hopefully progressively improved, we are now in a situation where, as Dr. Lamont and Dr. Mather said on the 2nd of May, we are closer to the point where the gap between referral for surgery at the centre and the surgery taking place is getting closer and closer to 12 weeks, which still, of course, is a significant wait for the person involved, but hopefully marks a degree of improvement over the time since the service was established.
To health boards to manage women with niche complications.
Sorry, Ms. White, we missed the beginning of that question.
Hello. So my question. Thank you. So the question was, I appreciate that you accept that H 2 weeks is not acceptable, but what guidance is being given to health boards to manage women with mesh complications?
So in response to that, I'd refer back to my earlier answer with regard to the responsible officers within each of the health boards, which there is direct contact with from NSS and the complex mesh surgical service.
Okay, thank you. So that was my first question, Minister. My second question is, when we had the meeting, the committee had the meeting on the 2nd of May, there was significant confusion about the referral pathway. So this is one thing I'd like to clear up today, if I may. So what work is being done to ensure the health boards follow the same referral pathways when mesh is identified as a factor? Thank you.
Thank you, Tess White, for that question, which was along the same lines as your colleague, Dr. Gulhani's. I have referenced the complex mesh surgical service pathway, which I have offered to send to the group. I was aware because of the evidence that you received on the 2nd of May that, however, I felt it was clarified in that session that it is required that it is an electronic referral from the health board to the service. And I think that was made clear by Dr. Mather. And as I say, the complex mesh surgical service pathway we'll send to the committee, so you have sight of that.
Thank you. Thank you, convener.
Carol Malkin has a brief supplementary on this.
Thank you. I just want to be clear in some of the points that you made. So from parliamentary questions, we know that from outpatient appointments, the median waiting time between referral and appointment at the Complex Mesh Surgical Service in Glasgow is 236 days, and the longest waiting time is 448 days. You know, I just want some clarity from the Minister on exactly how you have been approaching that with the Health Board. It is absolutely unacceptable, and as members have indicated, this is a long-standing commitment to women. So what discussion have you had with the Health Board, and what reassurances do you have for these women that we can get these appointment times closer?
I agree. Waiting times of that length must be incredibly difficult for the women waiting the referral and waiting for the discussions to find out what is their best pathway, the best course of action that they can be offered, and what is a very debilitating and pretty awful situation to find them in. So my officials are in regular correspondence and meetings with the health boards and NSS to ensure that everyone is across the pathways, understands the need to ensure that this is done with the patient at the centre of it, which I think is the way that we would hope to achieve any improvement in waiting lists. And as Greg Chalmers has indicated earlier, the whole system has been improved, having listened to those that are waiting to try and improve their experiences while they're waiting. So we've introduced a waiting well plan as well. And in my role as well with Women's Health, I'm looking to see how this can be connected into the Women's Health plan as well.
Just briefly, you know, I suppose people will want to hear very practical things like, will there be any extra clinic times? Will there be any extra, you know, resources? Will there be any extra, you know, nurses to give out that kind of advice? And I know you might not be able to answer that just now, but it would be helpful for the committee to know these kind of things for women.
Perhaps I think the member makes a very reasonable point about the range of points at which patients will be interested to see how the service is developing. As members know, the service has developed, I think, quite significantly in the period since it was established in 2020. It has, you know, got a wider range, as Dr. Kelly and Dr. Mathers were saying week before last. Psychologists, physiotherapists, as well as the clinical and nursing staff. And in terms of, but to come to the kind of direct question, we in the government have a relationship directly through National Services Scotland, who commission the service. They do that commissioning through a service level agreement, which was originally for 2 years and will be renewed shortly. Now, it's through that instrument that the government will seek to, working cooperatively with GGC, continue to seek improvement in all the issues that of waiting. Clearly, clearly improvement. I think it's reasonable to say that improvement has taken place in terms of waiting times, but clearly there's still more to do, and that's something that the minister and we as her team will be seeking to do together with NSS. If it's helpful to the committee, we can provide that service level agreement when it's renewed, because that hopefully will be useful to see the types of measures and metrics and plans that GGC has in place, some of which they explained to you a couple of weeks ago, to continue that improvement.
Thank you.
It is Stephanie Callaghan.
Thanks very much. Just stating what you were speaking about there, Greg, you were saying about systems have developed quite significantly since 2020, and certainly I would agree with that. However, women are still finding that things are confusing, misleading, inadequate. They've certainly described it as in the past there, and it's not the one-stop shop that they really expected this to be. So I'm wondering, just that grown knowledge and expertise, is there a place for the National Service to devise national guidance on actually managing those symptoms locally, particularly while women are waiting for long periods for appointments?
I think Stephanie Callaghan brings to the table a really important idea. For any women approaching any healthcare, a one-stop shop helps because we've got incredibly full lives. So if we can get all the information in one place, then I think that's helpful. I think we've got great learning from other areas in the Women's Health Plan. And very, very importantly, fantastic information from the women that have been through the centre and to make decisions as to whether they go for surgery to reverse or whether they decide on choosing the more, I think, the more conservative, the less surgical ways forward. And I think to enable women to make the best informed choices with regards to that, then I think we do have a responsibility to make that as clear and as open and as helpful to them so they can make the best decisions. So as I said earlier, with the Women's Health Plan, then I think this is something that we need to look at. And Greg and I have had some conversations about how we integrate that as well.
Perhaps just to add briefly, in terms of both an integrated service at GGC, but also joining up the different parts of the healthcare system, which is something the committee talked about on the 2nd of May. I think what we've tried to do with GGC, with NSS, with the accountable officers, is see how that chain of information and guidance is working as best as it can. And so, for example, on at the committee's previous session, we mentioned, Dr. O'Kelly mentioned that we were in the final stages of putting together using an existing package of training for GPs, conscious of the number of things that GPs, will have to look at, but hopefully that will be of use in increasing awareness. But also, we've alluded a number of times this morning already to the accountable officers. I suppose what I would emphasise is that group, it's not just an email distribution list. It's a place where the accountable officers come together regularly, share experiences, of course, and share thoughts about how to communicate with their primary care networks and other people. So there's hopefully what we're seeking to do is through joining up national with boards with primary care networks and with GPs, trying to disseminate the best possible information to share it around so that GPs, when meeting a patient with relevant symptoms, is attuned to what they're likely to say. But we despite hopefully the websites that we've put in place, the information leaflets that we've put in place are all good and positive. But we come to this issue in a spirit of knowing that this is we hopefully made some improvement and there's steps still to be taken.
So I do appreciate that the website has been updated quite recently as well. A number of things have shown improvement, and I hope that will be pushed and that will continue to move at pace. But just to ask a slightly different question there as well, interested in data capture. So not quite sure if there's a definitive record of how many women are affected by transvaginal mesh and if there's a comprehensive system in place for data capture and if that's kind of spread right across the way, if it's being effectively collated. Thanks.
Absolutely.
I think I'll hand that over to Greg because he's been involved in this for much longer than I have. But if I may, on your last point as well, talking about, as Greg indicated, the GP training, I think when Dr. O'Kelly was with you last 2 weeks ago, he also talked about work that's happening with NHS England as well. So there's a four nations approach to this. And so there has been a lot of work done to try and connect NHS Scotland support for the GP training with that is that it's available in England. So I think that's really positive for women as well, because it's looking at how we can get the best resources to support women and the GPs able to support their patients.
I'm just, I know that some of my colleagues have got some big questions in GPs later on there.
Well, in which case I'll try to be as brief as possible. On the matter of information, I suppose two things in our minds here. In terms of the performance of the service, the specialist service, the number of referrals, the number of surgeries, the waiting times, hopefully that information, as the Minister has already alluded to, is already available and will continue to be available and will be addressed in the service level agreement in terms of expectations that I mentioned earlier to Ms. Mockin. Looking to the future, and this is about the future, we have, with a number of health boards, been developing a pelvic floor registry with information about relevant procedures that are undertaken in health boards, and that and the types of devices that are used. And that, you know, is one of the ways in which the government has been trying to respond positively to the Cumbly's report and its recommendations. We've been working with the other three countries in the UK on the development of clinical outcome registries, and work on that continues. And within NHS Scotland, we have been continuing to develop our Scan for Safety programme, whereby particular and this is where Dr. Kelly would be useful to describe it correctly, but I will try to specify types of implantables. Their implantation will be recorded and linked to patients and clinicians so that the sorts of circumstances that very unfortunately gave rise to this circumstance, to this situation, we are seeking for the future to put in place systems that will more quickly detect when that is beginning to happen, so that the system can respond and clinicians can respond appropriately.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
So continuing on that theme of communication and information, I'm going to bring in David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Good morning, Mr. Chalmers. In evidence to the committee, Dr. O'Kelly acknowledged that communication and information could be better improved. So, Minister, why is the website for National Service still work in progress, considering it has been running for a number of years? And why is there no direct hyperlink from NHS NSS website to a website for complex mesh surgical services?
I think I kind of refer back to earlier questions that I think it's important that we get the website right, we get the support for the women that are in this situation right. Currently, the website has got a good amount of information in it. Could it be improved? Yes, I think there's an argument that a lot of websites could be improved to ensure that people are getting the right information and the right support from them. I think it's a piece of work that has been continuing in parallel to ensure that the actual experience that women, when they are referred, get the best service as well. So the improvement, the moving to the new Victoria Hospital and the welcoming and the support and the environment there has been improved. And I think, I suppose everything depends on priorities and resources, and so there, I think it's right that some of that priority has gone towards the actual location where women are first given their support in situ. I take on board, though, that the website needs to be improved. And with regards to the hyperlink, we were actually just talking about that yesterday, and saying that would be, I would have expected, quite a quick win to be able to have that hyperlink into the service. So therefore, it is as soon as you go on to the NHS Inform website or the NSS website that you get directly to the service that you're looking for.
Thank you for that, Minister. Minister, what more work is required to be done for women following the NHS route with communication to their GPs around appointments, surgery, follow-up treatment? Is a standard letter enough, or can that be improved?
I think a lot of services around this could be improved, and that's what we're learning from the women that have experienced the situation, which is why I know that a lot of listening has happened, because I appreciate that women didn't feel at the start that they were being listened to. So to support them even more, listening has been absolutely key. And I think if anyone has experienced surgery, then the best information you can get is as much information as can be given. And sometimes a simple letter isn't enough, which is why there has been an increase, or they've introduced phone calls for women after surgery as well. And I think that's incredibly important, because I know I suffered some surgery, and the first 24 hours after surgery, you're really not taking on board what people are saying. So I think ways that can be found to keep the women more informed, and also their families as well. That's as important as well, because that's where their main support will be once they've left the hospital environment. So I think there can be improvements, and I hope that will happen. And I think, as we've talked about, the accountable officers in the health boards and the additional information to the GPs should provide that level of support that women rightly should be expecting.
Thank you. No further questions.
Sandesh Gohani has a supplementary on this.
Thank you. Minister, David Torrance was asking you about the website, and I believe you said that the website needs to be improved. So I went into Google and I put in NHS GGC complex mesh, and the hyperlink comes up, and it says, "It seems we can't find what you're looking for. There is nothing."
Dr. Gohani, that was exactly part of my comments yesterday, because when I did the same thing. So that's something that we have taken away, and we'll find out why that is the situation.
Thank you. I'm going to move to Evelyn Tweed.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Good morning, Greg. my question is around preventative guidance for women and girls. Obviously, stress, urinary incontinence is a huge issue. I was lucky enough when I had my children that I was given guidance immediately about pelvic floor exercises, what to do after having a baby, etc. But do we need to standardise what information is given to women and girls, and should it start in schools and be disseminated across to make sure everyone knows what to do?
I thank Evelyn Tweed for that question, and I sadly didn't get the same training as you got. I haven't got children, but I absolutely recognise the conditions and the results of that. Now, in primary school and secondary school, different exercises, absolutely. I think that would be a really strong way forward. And I know that Emma Harper, in the evidence session on the 2nd of May, raised this concern as well. And through the women's health process, the women's health group, on their websites, they are about to launch, hopefully this summer, some short animations and support to help women understand the importance of doing muscles for their pelvic area. So I think that's a really positive way forward, and again, really, really reflects the importance of having the Women's Health Plan, which can react and respond positively when there is a need, a specific need that women can see. So I would love to see yoga teachers or Pilates teachers coming into school to give women support, and I think that's a good suggestion from Ms. Tweed.
Is there any sort of programme sort of considered for schools to actually talk about this to girls from an earlier age before they even think about having children, etc.?
Thank you for that question. So either this week or early next week, I have got a meeting with Natalie Dawn, who's the Minister for Young People. So this will be one of the things that we can talk about at that meeting, to see what solutions we might be able to put into place.
So I'm aware, Minister, that the Women's Health Champion has been recently appointed, and I absolutely appreciate why menopause, heart disease in women, endometriosis have been prioritised within her role, and those are the areas, very important areas, that Scottish Government's working on. But I'd be keen to hear from yourself about how you see the Women's Health Champion's role within promoting good pelvic health, if I can put it that way, in terms of the education that Evelyn Tweed spoke about. And I'd also be keen to hear about the government's plans for reviewing the incontinence strategy.
Okay, I thank the convener for that question. I was very pleased to meet Professor Anna Glazier very early on after being appointed. And I think she is, her skills and her personality really embed exactly what women would like to see in their health champion. As you indicated, we've prioritised on menopause and endometriosis. And I will be having further discussions with the women's health team about how we expand on these. I think it's important to say that Anna Glazier is the champion, but we've also got a group of I've got a group of officers that are working further on the plan, and Greg leads the group specifically on this. So I think we've got a lot to do. I was saying in a meeting last week that until we can say health without having to put women's health beforehand, we've got a long way to go. But I'm confident that Professor Glazier's leadership, and also the wealth of groups of women that want to get involved in women's health and want to really increase its increase it to the headlines, I suppose. It can only be welcomed. If I may, the incontinence plan, I'm afraid I haven't got any information on. But
yes, convener, I think I'll have to undertake to come back to you on that in writing. But we will.
My apologies.
I think that would be really helpful, given that we obviously want to move to a preventative strategy as opposed to treatment, and giving women and girls the information that they need about looking after their pelvic floor. I think that's really important for the committee to hear. I'm going to move to Stephanie Callaghan.
Thanks very much, convener. And I couldn't agree more. When we're talking about stress urinary incontinence, it's something that's often very, very treatable, and a lot of women think they just have to live with it. So I'd love to see something like that come along into our schools as well. However, my question is around peer support, and I'm wondering if the Minister would recognise that there is perhaps a need for formal mechanisms to provide peer support. I know certainly there's the Scottish Mesh Survivors, but you know, a lobby group isn't what every woman wants to be involved in. So I'm wondering if there is a need for that, and that's something that's formalised in other countries. Is that something that you'll be looking at? Thanks.
Thanks, Stephanie Callaghan, for the question. If I'm being honest, it's not something that I have specifically looked at with regard to mesh survivors. However, I have experienced some really positive experiences of groups together. So we indicated earlier, we talked earlier about menopause, and I think that there's been amazing support groups. Even St Mirren Football Club has created a menopause chat group. So I would like to see that happening. I would also perhaps suggest that the other way of doing that is through maybe third sector organisations. And as an MSP, I have quite regular conversations with the chief officer of Argyll and Bute Health and Social Care Partnership, and it's talking with them about how they are supporting women's health within that health area, health board area, and thinking about what connections you can make perhaps with the third sector interface or other women's health groups that can support. So I'm interested in looking at that, because I have seen great success of self-help groups in other areas.
And just to put it on the record, Convener, I'm aware that our colleague Emma Harper isn't with us today, but that she has suggested the possibility of something like a Maggie's Centre might be a great idea going forward. So just to put that on your radar, Minister. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to move to the next theme and to Carol Malkin.
Thank you. I'm interested in the link, you know, with the GPs. It's such an important part, must be maybe perhaps the first port of contact, and women have found that quite difficult. Two reasons: of course, we know GPs are under enormous stress, and you know, I'd be interested to know what is out there to help GPs in that setting around the transvaginal mesh. But what was brought up to us in our last session is this important point about records and medical records, and why are GPs unable to easily sort of ascertain whether women have had mesh implanted or not? So do we have an understanding of how we might resolve that issue? And do GPs get good information about symptoms? Some of the women have reported that they have gone with the symptoms of this to their GP and they've been unaware, and or it's been delayed in actually getting a diagnosis and a referral.
Yeah, I've read some of the reports from women that really struggled to really explain and be listened to by their GPs in the years leading up to I think probably 2015 when it was really given front page billing in media reports, and that I can't imagine how frustrating that must have been to the women. I think the work that has been done in Scotland and the work that this Parliament has done cross-party has really helped improve everyone's knowledge of the impact of vaginal mesh on women. And I think, as well as I indicated earlier, the fact that we've set up this specialist service, and specialist services are being set up in NHS England as well, and there's also options to go abroad, I think that's really helpful. And I indicated it earlier in a supplementary answer to Stephanie Callaghan about the training that NHS England for GPs has created, and the importance of the work that Dr. O'Kelly is doing to ensure that Scottish GPs can access that. And I think that is absolutely key to getting it right. But I also refer back to the individuals in each of the health boards as well that are there to support. If I may, Greg, can you cover the medical records?
Of course, yeah. We did, of course, the committee discussed that on the second, and perhaps I might then refer back to what I had mentioned earlier, which is the development of the pelvic floor registry, which is being trialled within four health boards, which will allow for the recording of all treatments for pelvic organ prolapse and stress urinary incontinence, as well as mesh removal procedures. I think that's a hopefully, we hope, an important development in this area, because as the member says, the ability for clinicians, GPs and others under significant pressure on a daily basis, the ability to access quality information quickly about particular procedures for a patient involving particular NHS settings and particular devices, the ability to get to that information quickly in a way that doesn't involve sending away for records, is a potentially powerful improvement that we can progress in the coming years. And I say we are working on that at the moment with four health boards, and that's part of that wider scan for safety, which, not for me to talk about, legacy or anything like that, but what we're trying to do positively through this, through understanding and hopefully improving the situation that has impacted on so many people, so that we have more and more occasions where more and more NHS staff and GPs and others are able to access information that can be that warning signal in advance, and also for the individual patient, but also at the system level, so that a number of incidents occurring in a number of places become obvious much more quickly. And I think that's, if we can make that improvement through Scan for Safety, I think that will be an important change and important improvement.
Can I just come back briefly, just because it has been mentioned to us, about, learning the lessons from this, and about having perhaps easy to access registry systems if people have. So in other areas like hernia mesh devices, whether the government have considered, that we should have that sort of easy access style for these things so that GPs could get information. I don't know, it's just that other people have raised it with us in the past.
Well, at the moment, and let me say, I'll confirm this in writing, because I think I'm getting into the clinical area where I should be careful. I don't think it is the case that the pelvic floor registry is touching upon hernia mesh, but let me commit to confirming that in writing later.
That'd be helpful. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. We move to Sandesh Gohani.
Thank you. As a practicing GP, I can tell you that access to records is shocking. And it's not good enough to say we're going to create a new system and GPs might be able to access that, because I already log into three different systems and it takes forever to go searching for things. So this new system you're creating, how is that going to be linked in to what already exists in GP records?
Well, let me be straightforward to the member and say that I don't know the operational detail of that. But it's something which is under development, and we'll be very happy to provide speak with the health boards involved. As I say, we've got four health boards involved in the pilot, and I think the member makes a very important point that when we develop, whether the government or health boards develop new systems, the integration with what is there already is clearly a critical success factor. So I suppose what I'm doing is agreeing with you, and think that's clearly something that we need to, that the pilots will need to reflect upon and ideally draw some conclusions on. But it's work in progress, and I think that's an important aspect of it.
And just to go back to Carol Mockin's questions about GPs and accessing information, a lot of the times I do not know what surgery a patient in front of me has. A lot of the times that patient doesn't know the details of the surgery that they have had. So you can send me all the information you want about things that women who have mesh might experience, but if I don't know this person has had a mesh implanted, how am I going to put two and two together?
I think, Dr. Gilhani, that's a very fair question. And I, in some of the reading that I was doing in preparation for this, I recognise the exact kind of examples that you've given from some of the responses from women, and also some other articles that I've listened to that women didn't know exactly or couldn't remember exactly what, or hadn't been told exactly what had happened to them. So I would hope, as a very much a lay person and someone that goes to a doctor for advice, that their training, their knowledge would allow them to ask the appropriate questions of their patient, which I'm sure the vast majority of them do, and then be able to either eliminate or say, right, the next pathway, the next step on that is perhaps to refer to get a scan to see what's happened. I'm only a patient, but that's what I would hope, that if I went to a GP to explain some of the symptoms that I had, as I indicated earlier to Carol Mochan, that the increase in knowledge of this and the support that I believe the health boards have put in to support GPs, plus the training, will move to allow better diagnosis. But I absolutely get what you say about historically, perhaps all that information wasn't captured.
Forgive me, you're not just a patient, you're the minister in charge. And I think having a safety mechanism there to ensure that this occurs is very important. As far as GPs being able to coordinate patient care, when we have a scenario where a GP would refer into a service and that service then refers into NHS GGC and there's multiple players involved, it's impossible to keep track of where that is. Do you feel a simplified method might be better in these type of circumstances?
By me, you are absolutely correct. I am the minister. However, I am also a patient, and the experience that I was giving you was from my own experiences. And I think that is actually a strength of a lot of MSPs and a lot of people, everyone sitting around this table, in that we all come to discussions and debates and policy with the experiences that we have. So I think it's important for me to reflect that in answering my questions, as you reflect the fact, and I respect very much the fact, that you are a practicing GP. And so therefore, I take on board absolutely what you've said. Yes, I think it would be wonderful to have a simple system that allows it all. It allows everything all to be accessible, but also I think we also have to recognise that there is requirements around GDPR, which is very high up on a doctor's list about confidentiality and such. But the premise of your point, yes, I think a simplified system would be helpful.
Sorry, forgive me, Minister. GDPR is an issue when it comes to referrals?
No, not at all. No, I was saying with regards to how information is stored and accessible.
Okay.
I'm going to move to Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, Convener, and morning, Minister. Obviously, the service we have at the moment is the complex mesh surgical service, and ongoing there will be women who will undoubtedly need surgery further into the future. There will be many that will have surgery that will not resolve their symptoms but may remove the mesh. So I'm interested in how this service evolves as we go through that process of some of these women receiving that surgical intervention. Do you believe the service will evolve to treat some of the ongoing symptoms, such as pain? I don't think it's entirely appropriate for maybe some of these women to end up in generalised pain clinics because of the issues they've faced. What do you believe this next evolution should look like, and how long it should be in place?
Thank you, Gillian Mackay, for your question. I think in the reading that I've done and the way that I've seen the service change over the last couple of years, it has moved to absolutely that holistic service. And I think early on in this session, I mentioned the fact that it has to be based on the person, on the patient. And so I strongly believe that the way that we can provide the best support for the women in this situation is by understanding what their needs are. And I think it's about a third of referrals that end up not choosing to go for surgery, but look for the holistic support, whether it's physiotherapy, whether it's pain support, whether it's well-being support as well. So if it's currently one third, then that could increase. So I think the system has to be, or the service has to be aware of that that possibility of increasing that element of the service. So I hope it will evolve, and I can see that Greg's nodding here. You might want to add something. I hope it will evolve to support women in the way that they feel is most appropriate to their own circumstances.
No, just to agree with the Minister, as she indicated, the service has evolved, and I think I think that's been broadly welcome for it to have a wider range of clinical and other colleagues involved. And as I mentioned earlier, we'll be renewing the service, so NSS will be renewing the service level agreement shortly, and I think we'll want to reflect that evolution. And I think Ms. Mackay makes a really important observation in that there's going, the service continues to evolve, and it will be a difficult judgment, a judgment that should be thought about carefully in terms of services that are provided at the specialist centre and services that are provided locally, because one of the things quite reasonably, people being referred from the islands or from northeast, it's a long way to go, and so there's a balance of pros and cons there, of course.
Absolutely, and you've preempted my next question wonderfully. Obviously, we'd want to see a lot of care for people delivered in the community, but as you said, there's much of this that's a specialist service that has to be delivered in certain places due to that specialism. For women who have maybe had that surgery, have maybe been discharged because of that, but feel that they need some of that wider holistic support, is there thought going on currently about how, whatever period down the line that is, that these women can be referred back quickly and don't have the length of waits that we've seen accessing the service in the first place to be able to get some of this more holistic support that is maybe not necessarily surgical in its first instance in nature?
I think that's a natural follow-on, and I would hope, given that the service has provided good as improving its support for people that are pre-referral and then also post-referral, then I think there has to be an indication on the patient's records that this has happened, so that the GPs and the local health boards, and then we also have the official in the local health boards as well, that there is a recognition that additional support may be required. I've had meetings with other groups with other concerns about the way that their treatment for women's conditions are, and that's something that they've talked about as well. So not wanting to increase the pressures on the women's health plan, but I think there's something to think about there more holistically across health delivery for women in Scotland, to ensure that the aftercare they get is appropriate to the surgery and the roundabout surgery support they've had as well.
That's great. Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
And we have a supplementary question from Tess White.
Thank you, Convener. I'm minded of the patient, the woman who had to wait a year and a half for an urgent referral. So just a thought, sometimes GPs are unable to help women who require the mesh removal. So would it be better off that GPs can refer directly to CMSS, or is there another way to get through the bottleneck that there seems to be? Thank you.
I thank Tess White for that question, and I think you have to strike the balance, and this was, I think, given very clearly in evidence to you on the 2nd of May. about the importance of having one route that everybody understands, and that would avoid any confusion or cluttering of the landscape. So I think what I've taken away from the questions that you have asked, Ms. White, is that we need to ensure that GPs are absolutely clear as to what the pathway is, and look at ways of ensuring that is the case, perhaps writing directly to the health boards and their officers that are responsible for this. But I think to add another pathway in might cause confusion, which maybe isn't the best way of supporting women that are in desperate need of this support.
Thank you. Hopefully we'll monitor it very closely. Thank you.
Thank you. So in evidence, the committee heard about the curriculum and framework published by the Royal College of Obstetricians and Gynaecologists for specialist training in mesh complications. And I'd be keen to hear about the clinicians who have been through that training. And if you're able to give us numbers, are all surgeons involved in mesh removal in Scotland, have they been through that training so far?
So I know that Dr. Kelly, when he spoke, he talked about credentiality across the four nations. I'm not clear how far these discussions have gone, but I do know that the surgeons that are operating in Scotland are trained to very high standards. I don't know, Greg, if you've got anything. I think probably what we'll do is it's probably best if we come back to you with an indication as to the progress of how the credentiality across the four nations is going, and also numbers of those trained.
Thank you, Minister. I think that would be very helpful. I think Sandish Gulhani has a question on this theme too.
Absolutely. Just touching on credentialing, what is the Scottish Government's position on credentialing?
As we've said earlier, Dr. O'Kelly isn't here, and I think that is an area that I would ask him to answer your question on, because it is specifically clinician-led. But I think it is a very positive way forward to have a standard, a high standard that is set, and that's what credentialing will allow us to have across the four nations.
And do you envisage credentialing to move into GP?
I don't feel I am qualified to answer that question.
Would you write to us with a response?
I'm sure we could write to you with that response.
Okay. And so with the clinic that has been set up, there's obviously a key member missing. We don't have a specialist within the clinic for urogynaecology. This is causing a bit of angst with a lot of women. That's certainly right to me, and I think we've heard a lot of people talking already about issues when it comes to continence for women. And certainly I just very quickly want to say that it's a real shame that women don't come to their GP, because there's a lot that we can do, and it's certainly not wasting my time for women to come and see me when they have issues, which is what I think a lot of women feel, very sadly. But with the specialist, when do you envisage that we will have somebody in place?
So I am aware that you asked this question 2 weeks ago, and I think the response that was given is that there is active recruitment happening at the moment. There are urology specialists in Scotland that are able to support as and when is required. I'm afraid I can't give you a time frame for that happening, but I have been informed, and it has been underlined that is a key appointment that people are working to progress.
Okay.
And I agree with you. I think women should be able to approach their GPs very regularly with whatever concerns they have, and get the right support that I know GPs can provide.
If I might add, just for just so it's clear, Minister and members entirely right, that there's not a person employed directly in GGC of this type at the moment, but just to emphasise that the service has access to that type of support through another health board in Scotland, and so the advice is there, understanding that it's not presently in the employ of GGC.
And my final question, when I was training to be a GP, I was actually at the Royal, and Dr. Ros Jameson was was one of the trainers that I had in obstetrics gynaecology, and I understand that she's no longer within NHS GGC. Certainly something you can't comment on as individual consultants. But my concern here is when we have consultants moving, when we have staff turning over, when you've got such a specialist clinic, which is already looking like it's a little bit under strain, what can we do to protect the service?
So I'm not sure I would categorise it as under strain, because we have, as we've given evidence and as you received evidence 2 weeks ago, it is clear that the service is improving, is listening to women, and in answer to Carol Mochan's questions earlier, waiting times have reduced, and women, the responses to surveys carried out by NSS are showing that there is women perceive an improvement in service. So, but I think the point that you raise is an appropriate one with regard to availability of people to work in that specific area and other specialist areas. And that's why I think we've got to continue to ensure that the NHS in Scotland can get the right access to good people and ensure that we can employ the best people that we can. And I would hope that the importance of NHS surgery and support for women is recognised, and that we can employ the appropriate consultants and such like. But I think also to look at it from the other perspective, it's when you look at centralising some or putting care in one specific centre, then again that gives that a centre of excellence, which and I think it was Dr. Kelly in his evidence said that it's well thought of and well perceived service within the wider United Kingdom. So therefore that I think is important, to have that centre where there is all the skills in the one place, as opposed to perhaps having that more spread out across Scotland. I think I'm right in saying that we've got the one centre in Scotland, there's nine in England, and that kind of reflects population need. So I think I would hope that given it is seen at such a high standard, that we will continue to attract the right people to work there to ensure that women get the right health support that they need.
Thank you, Minister. And I'm aware that we've taken you over our allotted time, but Stephanie Callaghan just has one brief question before we finish the session.
Thanks very much, Convener, for allowing me in. So the Minister will be aware that the Patient Commissioner for Scotland Bill is currently making progress through Parliament, and also that Professor Alison Britton's case review and transvaginal mesh is coming through as well there. Suppose really just to get it on the record, hopefully, can I just check that, you know, that the Minister will be highlighting the need of learning and work taken forward, improvement work taken forward from transvaginal mesh when the Patient Commissioner for Scotland is appointed?
Thank you very much for raising that point, Stephanie. I think it's a really important piece of legislation that's going through Parliament just now, and you certainly highlighted that in your contribution to the debate last week. As was mentioned in the debate, it will be up to the Patient Commissioner, Safety Commissioner, to decide what areas that they will work on once if the bill is passed and becomes an act and they are in place. from my perspective. I think there is a huge amount of learning that we have to get on record and understand from the transvaginal mesh situation. So I wouldn't want to put something on that person's entry straight away, but I think it should be there.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Can I thank the Minister for Public Health and Women's Health and Greg Chalmers for their attendance this morning and for their evidence. The committee will look forward to seeing the written responses that the Minister and our official have committed to. So thank you. At our next meeting next week, we will continue our scrutiny of NHS boards as well as taking further formal evidence as part of our inquiry into female participation in sport and physical activity. And that concludes the public part of our meeting today.